Edwards is the traditional base for testing. Once called Muroc, this Air Force facility has been the home of many major test programs. Here, from the dry Californian desert, the first B-1, with the hopes of Rockwell and the Air Force in the balance, would undergo the most thorough flight testing. All the while, its detractors looked for the slightest flaw to capitalize on. Already, there had been problems with cost overruns. These had been added to by the government decision to produce fewer test planes, substantially increasing the unit cost. Also, the decision to stretch the early delivery schedule created problems with the aircraft's 3,000 subcontractors. Logistics must have been a nightmare. Although the first short flight of the B-1 was a totally successful exercise, its future was still far from secure. And much of the real flak the program was to encounter had little to do with the plane's performance. Rather, the arguments were of need, philosophy, and politics. Did the Air Force really require a new bomber? How valuable was a recallable manned deterrent? Genuinely informed assessments of whether the B-1 might be able to achieve its mission requirements were less easy to find. And against this backdrop of uncertainty, engineers and test pilots would have to prove Rockwell's super bomber. As the testing continued, the sole flying example of the B-1 was carefully put through various stages of the test program. Soon, the enormously powerful and complex landing gear was to be retracted and extended. Years earlier, when Rockwell was still called North American, and it was testing the XB-70 Valkyrie on its first prototype mission, the gear failed to retract properly. But the B-1's initial attempt at a clean profile flight was a total success. With something as complicated as the undercarriage, tremendous effort is expended in testing prior to flight, but in the end, the one that really counts is in the air. Throughout 1975, Rockwell's single flying B-1 ran a gauntlet of tests, including the crucial wing sweep function from straight wing to delta shape. There was a comprehensive testing of the four General Electric F-101 fanjet engines and of the delicate task of aerial refueling necessary even for a plane with the B-1's range. It was tested in high-level flight at over 50,000 feet, then down to the deck for the all-important below-the-radar barrier trials, flying over 600 miles an hour at less than 200 feet. In these circumstances, the small vanes of the low-altitude flight control system were vital. Government cuts to the program meant that only three prototypes were to be built. The first of these was to fly, and the second was for structural testing. At the end of 1975, the stress tests were complete, and the aircraft was released to be fitted out for flying. But it would not be available till May of the following year. In January of 1976, the third aircraft, built for flight testing, came online. This aircraft would concentrate on much of the complex avionics equipment used in the B-1 program, especially the Boeing-built offensive electronic system, a vital part in the B-1 mission. Inside the cockpit of these prototypes, a complicated array of dials and meters surrounds the cathode ray tubes. If you look closely, you can see the fighter-like control columns, unusual in a large aircraft. Directly behind the pilot and co-pilot, the other two crew members sit in their positions. The defensive and offensive systems operations use the high point of radar development not only to identify and target the enemy, but also to fend off attacking opposition fighters. It's a far cry from the air gunner huddled in the rear of the B-17. The B-1 crew fly in comfort, but in combat, they'd face the same old risks, fighting off late 20th or 21st century bandits. As the testing of the first three aircraft continued, with the speed and altitude envelope being constantly pushed, a fourth plane, authorized for August 1976 production, started its early stages of construction. With this latest B-1 underway, it seemed the program had gained sufficient momentum to survive its critics. With so much research behind it, and so many of the problems solved, it appeared certain the Rockwell bomber would continue into production. But then, on June 30th, 1977, the recently elected Carter administration canceled the project, and the B-1 program came to a halt. A unit cost of over $100 million was not the least of the reasons for cancellation, but there were others.